Mr. Fitzgerald.
Director Wray, on May 14, 2021, yourself as Director of the FBI and the Secretary of DHS, in consultation with Director of National Intelligence, jointly produced the report containing a strategic assessment and data on domestic terrorism. Of note, the FBI finally designated the 2017 shooting of congressional Republicans as an act of domestic terrorism carried out by a domestic violent extremist rather than suicide by cop. As the FBI initially had classified the shooting, how did the FBI initially reach its conclusion that the attack was suicide by cop? And who made the determination? And then ultimately, why was there a change, do you believe?
Well, Congressman, I appreciate the question. So, as you may know, after I think a very thoughtful conversation I had with Congressman Wenstrup in April, I asked my team to go back and take a hard look at that particular shooting. And I think what we found is that from the time that I first arrived as director, the FBI's understanding of domestic violent extremism has evolved. And more we see domestic violent extremists motivated by mixes or almost mishmashes of ideological, socio-political, and personal grievances. And I think the shooter at the baseball practice that day back in 2017, I think is fairly considered an early example of that phenomenon. And so that's part of why I wanted to be clear that the FBI considers that shooting an act of domestic terrorism, that we look at it under the umbrella of domestic violent extremism, and that if the same thing had occurred today, we would absolutely open it as a domestic terrorist investigation. And we tried to make that explicit both directly to Congressman Wenstrup and in the report that you referred to, which we formally transmitted to Congress.
So would you consider that a change in posture by the FBI on domestic terrorism overall?
Well, it's part of a, I don't know about posture, but it's part of a more evolved understanding of the way in which domestic violent extremism affects this country. We are seeing much more often now, not people who commit attacks based on some nice, neat, cookie-cutter ideology, and this is their sole motivation, but rather people who take bits and pieces of things together with some personal beef and then attack. And we consider that to be, in many ways, the most increasingly common form of domestic violent extremism. And so, again, I would view not so much a change in posture as that attack was one of the earlier versions of this phenomenon that is quite rampant now. Like just the other day, we had these folks in Minneapolis, for example, who were so-called Boogaloo Boys, but they were ultimately charged with trying to provide material support to Hamas. We had a guy the other day who was subscribing to various Islamist violent extremism, but also considered himself a neo-Nazi. And then with all of them, wrapped up with them, you have these people who blend into it personal agendas, have nothing to do with ideology at all. And so when you put all that together in sort of a salad bar of motivations, we think it's fair to look at something like the Simpson Field shooter as a domestic violent extremist, a domestic terrorist. And that's why, again, if it would happen today, I think we would certainly consider that part and parcel of what we call domestic terrorism.
So since the George Floyd incident, there's been hundreds of flare-ups domestically in many of the larger municipalities throughout the nation. And, you know, it was a long, hot summer last summer. What is the approach that the FBI is taking as we are at the beginning of June, as we look forward, and what is the approach that the FBI is using with those types of domestic flare-ups that we're seeing again across the nation?
Well, we're lashed up very tightly with our state and local partners. When I go, and I've been to all 56 of our field offices, most of them more than once, I'm almost at all of them at least twice now, I've met with law enforcement from all 50 states, chiefs, sheriffs, commissioners, colonels, et cetera. And we're all very concerned about the rise in violent crime, the homicide rates in particular, and we all think that in some ways the summer could be the worst yet to come in a while. And so we're through our Safe Streets Task Forces, through on the terrorism side, our Joint Terrorism Task Forces, our Violent Crime Gang Task Forces, a whole variety of ways, we're working, trying to be lashed up very tightly with our state and local partners to do our part. And again, the FBI is just one part of a broader law enforcement response to try to make sure that we do our best to protect our neighborhoods.
Gentleman's time has expired.
Yield back.
Gentleman yields back.
Christopher Wray was flat out lying right there. And the fact is, he is an incompetent director. He was not qualified for this job. I think I'm a huge Trump supporter, but I think it was one of the biggest mistakes of the Trump presidency was putting Christopher Wray in there. And I think he showed it, especially in this, his opening remarks that he made today, how biased he actually is, because everything that he said, especially about extremist violence, was completely sided to the left. Everything that had to do with any type of group that calls themselves patriots or anything that happened on January 6th was noted and displayed by his language as something that is far extreme with very little, if any, people that were there to be peaceful. And he made it sound as though the left is mostly peaceful with just a few things. Everything that comes out of this guy's mouth is pushed to the left, but it's subtle. So if you've been a prosecutor or a U.S. attorney, or if you've been in the FBI and you listen to his language, you can literally see this. And I think some of these congressmen and congresswomen actually saw this today, and I think they went after him, but he's not going to bend as far as that goes.
I will tell you that I have spoken directly to FBI agents that are investigating January 6th, issues, and ranging from individuals that were in the Capitol to individuals who were not in the Capitol. One thing that stands out, the most recent conversation I had with an FBI agent here in Salt Lake indicated, he said he's never seen anything like this. They are given a mandate. They are to go out. They have been given the questions they're supposed to be asking. They have been given the way they're supposed to proceed on this case. They don't have individualized authority. It is all coming from Washington, D.C. I've spoken to prosecutors that are prosecuting these cases. And this is not individualized justice. They are lumping everybody into the same category, and they are treating them unlike I've ever seen in a case. The Department of Justice is supposed to address every single case, unless it's a conspiracy case, according to the criminal conduct of that individual. They're not doing that. None of the prosecutors have authority. It's all coming straight from Washington, D.C.
There is so much energy put towards these people, and there's not the same energy put towards Antifa. Why didn't he explain that? Why couldn't he explain that?
Well, I don't think he could explain it because, again, he was making this into more of a political stand. And, he said there were three categories of people on January 6th. He failed to completely mention the people who were literally invited into the Capitol building by the Capitol Police. And the majority of the people that were there did nothing. He made it sound as though if you came on the Capitol grounds, you were an extremist. And that is just not the case. There were some violent people there. There were some people that went into the Capitol that did some very nefarious things. But his the way he categorized these people was absolutely wrong. And the way that the FBI has systematically, as Brett just pointed out there, been told how to investigate January 6th, they've systematically been kept from truly investigating or going after the leftists. And that is so clear because of the way that there's just nothing going down about these individuals on the left. And I'll just say one other thing. In all my time in the FBI, the only white supremacist case that I ever saw, and I was in New York the entire time, was prison-related. There was no white supremacy, massive agenda going on in the United States, and it's not happening now. And it's another example of how they use these things and push them out in the media.
When you think about what Antifa did last summer, the number of federal properties that they destroyed or defaced, and the money that they caused to small businesses, the police officers who they injured, the Secret Service members, they really haven't been held accountable to the same type of behavior that they did all last summer. Why not?
They have not been. I mean, you think about what domestic terrorism is. When you burn down a police station and you take over city blocks, that's domestic terrorism. And they have not been held accountable. I'm ashamed to say that, my my former office, you know, the Department of Justice. I wish I could see courage. I wish I could see U.S. attorneys standing up. You know, it's interesting. I represent an individual who went into the Capitol, was told she could go in, and was actually pointed by a security guard to the direction she should go. And she's being prosecuted. She's being charged with misdemeanors. She has no criminal history. She thought the only other Capitol she's ever been in is a state Capitol that's open 24/7. She thought you could walk in. So there's a wide disparity between, you know, who Chris Wray is identifying, and they want to prosecute every single person that was there to send a message. And that's what this is. It's message prosecuting. And that's never an appropriate decision by a prosecutor.